Grazie, grazie a tutti, buongiorno, bentrovati.
Welcome to the first important meeting on the first day of EIMA. Thank you so much. Thank you all for being here. I hope you will enjoy this EIMA session. This is the opening day, of course, and for this reason I just want to make a little introductory speech attempting to reflect many of the feelings that agricultural machinery producers are experiencing. Yesterday during the press conference before the opening of this 42nd edition of EIMA, it's clearly an event that is becoming stronger and stronger over the years, and I also want to thank the President of Bologna Fiera, Mr. Bonin, for being here today. As I was saying yesterday during this press conference, one point we underlined was that this event, of course, is also a promotion event, but it's also an event of great political relevance. During all the events we will attend in the next few days, that are very numerous, as has always been the case during EIMA, the interactions between and among many people here and hopefully in similar events in the future frequently highlight quite a number of things, not only business requirements, of course, and that's obvious, but there's another part, if you like, another area that seems to be dominating in these events. And I'm referring to all the problems and expectations in vital sectors such as agriculture and the mechanical industry. In this large room and also in the surrounding area, people develop new opinions, change their minds sometimes, learn new things that are viewed as factors of great importance for the whole sector. It's important to focus on policy on the one hand and on the clear definition of our priorities in this special moment in time. The mechanical industry has taken up a European stance very early, perhaps earlier than other sectors, for a number of reasons. And I want to thank President Marcel and all the members of the board because they really represent the essence of our sector in the European continent. What they did was clear evidence that this sector has always tried to adopt a Europe-wide approach. All the work made by them, including the provision of statistical data, information, technical support of companies, important contribution also in terms of political rules and regulations, led European businesses to identify a number of common denominators and a number of critical issues that require a careful political approach. So it's a great pleasure for us, of course, to have a chance of having this set of important people all around us so that we can directly discuss with them all these issues and discuss with them the requirements that may be the most important on both sides. I'm referring to representatives of industries, institutions, politics. I don't think we can actually separate the sectors in a clear-cut manner because they are so much intertwined and they all need each other. So that's why I think we need a common strategy. We need a set of common strategies. This is why I believe that this meeting is going to be very useful, very concrete. It's going to start from a document that identifies, highlights the key topics we want to address. We are going through a very difficult moment in Europe, of course. Economic crisis is widely disseminated everywhere, also among farmers. And this has a negative impact on the agricultural machinery businesses. And there's also an attempt to streamline bureaucracy, and that's good because bureaucracy is often the main obstacle we have in our work. There are several attempts to provide incentives to new entrepreneurs. And of course they represent our future. So all these things need to be monitored and followed carefully through a number of initiatives like ours today. So listening to the illustration of this document and to the following debate among our speakers, I'm sure is going to be extremely interesting for all of us, no matter where we come from. As you will see today, this is a meeting that groups together all people who are interested in the area of agriculture and the agri-food sector, which is much more complex and integrated than mere agriculture. I am personally acquainted with all the speakers that will speak today, and I want to thank them very much indeed for accepting our invitation. They have already cooperated with us on a number of occasions. We have fought a number of battles together with them, and I think that they really are the best panel for the discussion we're going to have today. We have representatives from a number of groups of companies that may are able to talk about politics, and two politicians and politicians that can communicate with industry. So I want to thank you again for your participation, and I officially open this conference and invite Michele Scannellini, the president of ITSE. Thank you. ITSE Bo. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I wish to thank President Contoni for his kind words. As he said, we are really friends. I think evidence of this is that we're wearing the same tie today. Next time, I think we should give a call to each other on the phone before we dress up. Now, speaking seriously, I want to make two considerations today, one concerning exports and one concerning innovation. As you know, the mission of ICE is to promote a made in Italy abroad. So we provide all kinds of support to increase our sales abroad and to improve our image abroad. This is a major opportunity since this is the most important trade fair in the world on agricultural machinery. It is part of a plan to stimulate Italian trade fairs, which is part of an extraordinary Made in Italy plan that has received 175 million euro allocation from the government, and part of this money is going to be used to promote trade fairs in Italy that can really become important and well-known worldwide. So the idea is to strengthen them even further. This is why we are working with great commitment and great enthusiasm to increase our support to EIMA this year. When I say support, I'm referring to our activity of selection and support to foreign exhibitors. This is going to be a record year in this sense. There are going to be 400 businesses represented here, foreign businesses, and 50 journalists. And they work in areas that we deem particularly important because they are still, there are areas where we still can improve mechanization in agriculture, such as Africa, Southeast Asia, and South America. So many of these businessmen that we will accompany throughout this exhibition come from these regions. And we have organized a number of business-to-business meetings, and this year there's going to be thousands of them. So this, I think, is a very important event for our export, and we want to provide all our help to contribute to its success. But I want to make a couple of comments also on the question of innovations. Before we started this session, I was in the central hall here, and I saw these 25 products that were especially innovative and have been selected for that reason. Innovative for agriculture, of course. Now, as you know, at the moment, the government has decided to allocate a largest amount ever to innovation. They're investing something like 20 billion euro on R&D and in the framework of this Industry 4.0 plan that probably you've heard about several times. It's not a matter here of dividing or separating industry from agriculture or trade. We're talking about innovation. Innovation concerns all of them. I have a long experience in many different sectors. I worked in five different sectors, basically. And I've always realized that when a sector is stagnating and demand is dropping, sales are not doing well, the only way to change the situation is to innovate. That's why innovation must be central in our minds. And what I saw today was really a genial application of some technological innovation. I saw the application of the Internet of Things, and that was extraordinary, or some collaborative robotics applications that I found equally interesting. So I'm really sure that whenever we talk about genius or innovation, Italians can do well, perhaps better than all the others. Thank you. Thank you, President Canalini, and thank you for highlighting one of the key issues, the key topic indeed of this event, and that is innovation. Innovation is part and parcel of your daily work. And now I give the floor to Richard Marco, the President of CEMA, to get a further insight into the topics that manufacturers are most interested in. Please remember that there's a simultaneous interpretation service.
It's with immense pleasure that I welcome you all here today on behalf of CEMA, the Association of Farm Machinery Manufacturers in Europe. Around 4,500 different companies producing around 500 different types of machines. I really look forward to a fruitful and constructive debate this morning. And it's clear that we could have found no better place to meet and discuss the very important subject of what we have termed a new European agenda for the agricultural machinery industry than the city of Bologna. It is home to the oldest university in the world. Bologna has a long and rich history as a European hotspot for learning, knowledge, and innovative thinking. So this should inspire all of us to come forward with some daring, forward-looking ideas today. Secondly, with regards to our industry, the Eima Fair turns Bologna every other year into one of the hotspots for some of the finest technology innovations in the farm machinery industry. So I cordially invite all of you, and I mean all of you, to see and experience this for yourself by wandering through the fairground after this event. And finally, and many of us had the chance to get a taste of this yesterday, Bologna is regarded as the city of food, a hotspot and home to some of Italy's most well-known and celebrated culinary traditions. So what, are you thinking, does that have to do with tractors and farm machinery? Well, a whole lot more than you might think at first. Because chances are that any of this fine food that you might have had the opportunity to taste while being here will have gone through at some stage one or several of the machines that you will see on display today. So more seriously, more fundamentally speaking, it is this defining purpose of our industry: to help farmers produce more food using less labour, with less land, in a sustainable manner and at affordable prices. That holds the key for a proper understanding of what Europe's farm machinery industry is ultimately all about. And I dare say, it is only by viewing the European farm machinery industry from its ultimate purpose and from the very particular needs of its end users, that's the farmers and the agricultural contractors, that we can really define what kind of regulatory and policy framework the industry needs right now and in the years to come. So this brings me straight to the core questions of our discussion here today. Why do we need a new European agenda for farm machinery? And secondly, what could such a new deal look like? So let me start with the first point. Why might we need a new European agenda at all? After all, the fundamentals of our industry look pretty impressive and reassuring. Europe is and remains the world's largest producer of farm machinery. And in terms of employment, the farm machinery industry is the largest agricultural input industry in the European Union. Thirdly, we are the global technology leader in innovation. And moreover, with precision agriculture and digital technology innovations, the pace of that innovation in this industry has never been faster. However, who you are today is not a reliable indication of who you will be tomorrow. So we need to look further, and much further. And when we do this, we need to look beyond those immediate industry fundamentals. Some formidable challenges begin to appear on the horizon. Essentially, we see three different types of challenges that we are facing in this industry. And taken together, these challenges could well have the potential of forming a perfect storm. And they are, firstly, longer-term structural challenges. Secondly, shorter-term cyclical challenges. We heard about some of those already this morning. And finally, regulatory challenges relating to EU policies and rules governing our industry. So we need to embrace them, discuss them, and more than anything, we need to address them. So ladies and gentlemen, the most fundamental long-term structural challenge in European farming is evident and well known. The overall number of farmers and farm holdings is constantly falling. If I take Germany as an example, the 472,000 agricultural holdings in operation in the year 2000 dropped to a mere 285,000 in 2013. That's a massive decline. And this trend shows no sign at all of stopping. Now, while this means that the average farm size is growing, and there is thus a structural demand for larger and stronger farm equipment, less farmers, on the other hand, also mean that the total European customer base for farm machinery has somewhat eroded and constantly fallen in recent years. And that does ultimately result in lower sales units and sometimes even in lower total engine power sold. Another structural long-term trend that we can observe is the relatively slow overall uptake of innovative farm machinery in Europe, and that's a tragedy. To give you another example from Germany, there are a total of 1.2 million tractors registered in Germany. The average tractor age is a staggering 27.5 years, hardly the latest technology. And the fleet is replaced only at an annual rate of around 33,000 new tractors. By contrast, the average passenger car on Europe's roads is less than 10 years old. In short, the investment cycles and amortization rates in farming and farm machinery are much, much longer than, for instance, in the automobile sector. And then we have the short-term cyclical challenges in farming, such as the current agricultural crisis in Europe. A recent European Parliament report confirmed what everybody in the world of farming has been knowing and experiencing for years. Namely, that the most sensitive investment component to agricultural market conditions is machinery. In other words, as soon as farm income comes under pressure, machinery investments are scaled back and machinery sales decline. This is the situation we are in at the moment. And as we speak, it is extremely difficult for many European farmers, and in particular small farmers, to invest in new machinery. Even if surveys among farmers consistently show that new machinery tops their investment priority lists. In other words, farmers want to invest, but often they just can't. And as such, we have the serious risk of a large investment gap in European farming, particularly when it comes to machine technology investments. So this is where the third type of challenge, the regulatory challenges, come into the picture. To be sure, as CEMA, we have always worked closely with the European Union in trying to harmonise machinery-related regulation across the EU and create a true single market for farm machinery. Yet despite the advances on this path and the overall success story that European integration and harmonisation has brought and is still bringing, also to our industry, our experience in the past years has also taught us a very different and greatly concerning trend. That EU regulatory compliance costs for farm machinery have risen sharply, very, very sharply. This by itself would be sufficiently difficult to cope with for an industry that is already battling a number of structural and cyclical challenges, as I've just described. Yet it turns into a threatening trend when you consider that these cost increases for the industry often came with little or no added value for the end users. In other words, we and all the farming community feel very, very squeezed. The list of new mandatory requirements the EU has introduced for farm machinery in recent years is very long, and is still getting longer and longer. They include a veritable avalanche of regulatory measures, such as a long series of new diesel exhaust emissions limits, as well as a whole range of new rules on the approval of farm machinery vehicle types. But one fundamental problem with most of these rules is that they are directly based on legislation originating from the automotive sector and were only subsequently extended to the agricultural machinery industry. However, the farm machinery and automotive industries are not comparable. In terms of their size, their structural setup, the commercial realities, and end use of the final products, they follow entirely different trends. For instance, can enforcing a costly ABS braking system on tractors driving between 40 and 60 kilometers per hour really be considered a sensible top priority for regulation? The available evidence does not say so. And most of our customers would disagree with such a step as well. And apart from adding administrative compliance costs, what really are the benefits of forcing small SME manufacturers of farm machinery to share their repair and maintenance information of their machines as of 2023? What such examples show in our view, and there are many, many others, is that we feel that such recent regulatory initiatives have actually not adequately taken into account the structural differences of the industry. We're a low volume industry with very many specialized niche market products and a very high number of SMEs. Not taking account of the requirements of its customers, the farmers and agricultural contractors, or even the agronomics of some of the machines in the field. And that such an approach risks putting the industry and EU farming at risk in the wake of fiercer global competition. So a real threat of making us less competitive with the rest of the world in this global economy. So with regard to this particular aspect, we therefore believe we need a veritable U-turn in terms of EU regulation to ensure European manufacturers of farm machinery, both big and small, can remain successful in Europe and beyond in the years to come. So this brings me to my final point. What could a new European agenda, a new deal for farm machinery, look like? Well, at CEMA, we believe such an agenda should be built on essentially two different but connected pillars. Firstly, an industry policy that boosts the innovative power and competitiveness of the industry on the supply side. And then secondly, a forward-looking, visionary agricultural policy that supports farmers in using innovative machinery and thus works, so to say, on the demand side as well. With regards to industry policy, we believe it is essential that EU regulation of our sector takes into account more strongly the structural realities and constraints of our industry, as well as the real needs of our end users, farmers, and agricultural contractors. What we and our customers cannot afford is to be faced time and time again with an approach that adds huge costs for the industry for little or no added consumer and customer benefits. So this is a point very, very well worth thinking about. Looking at Europe's agricultural policy, various studies by the European Parliament and European Commission's Joint Research Centre, the JRC, have recently demonstrated the extent to which smart farm machines and precision agriculture can help to promote sustainability in European farming. Precision agriculture helps farmers to do this by optimizing their input use and maximizing their productivity, whilst minimizing the impact on the environment. In addition, smart farm machines, together with digital farm management software, can greatly help to cut red tape costs and administrative burdens for farmers. But here's the problem. Today, by any statistical analysis, take whichever you like, either less than 20% or less than 25% of European farmers are today using any form of precision farming. And it's very clear that with this vision, this uptake must be increased. So the next rounds of CAP reform should therefore favour investment in precision farming and connected tools and services as a solution to both efficient, competitive European agriculture and to green farming. That's the solution. Ultimately, we believe such an approach would deliver far greater aggregate benefits for the farming sector in the context of the EU's environmental targets than any sort of automobile-driven regulatory approach, focusing solely on, for instance, engine emissions. At the same time, it would bring true added value for farmers themselves. So, ladies and gentlemen, let me stop here with my brief outline of the challenges and opportunities regarding Europe's farm machinery industry. Because one thing is clear, we will not be able to define, advance, or act upon a meaningful new European agenda for farm machinery by ourselves. To be successful, we need to discuss and work together, all sectors. And this discussion needs to include the perspectives and views our customers and end users, that's the farmers, young farmers, agricultural contractors, as well as the decision makers that regulate and impact our industry in Brussels, be it in the European Commission, in the European Council of EU member states, or the European Parliament itself. We need to embrace everybody together, but sharing the same vision for a competitive and positive future. And as such, we are greatly honoured and pleased to welcome amongst us today, Bologna, a number of high-level representatives, really from all of these groups. It is my deep conviction that the time to start the dialogue for a new European agenda for the machinery industry is here and now. And with this, I really look forward to an interesting and interactive debate. Thank you for being here today, and thank you very much indeed for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you, President Merkel, and thank you for the many important points you raised during your brief introduction. It was interesting to hear that only few farmers in Europe use precision farming. The calendar law on industry, 4.0 industry, the minister introduced a part of the text that refers to the support that will have to be given to precision farming in Italy and abroad. Of course, this requires cooperation between final users and manufacturers. And in fact, many of the comments that we heard focused specifically on this key topic. Let me just introduce the members of our roundtable today that will jointly discuss the topics raised. Pekka Pesonen, the Secretary General of Copper Sector, the organization that represents the European Agricultural Organization, Klaus Hansen, President of CETA, Alice Cerutti, if I'm not wrong, yes. Vice President of CESA, the European Association of Young Farmers, Barbara Bonvissuto, from the European Commission, Paolo De Castro. Will Trump victory change the relations between Italy and Europe? Well, we'll hear later on. And then finally we have Ms. Gardini from the Committee on the Environment of the European Parliament. I will give the floor to Elisabetta first because she has to leave later on for previous engagement. Is Europe still so bureaucratized and strict on that, or can we expect it to be more cooperative? Well, thank you very much. Thank you indeed for this invitation. Going back to your question, I think Paolo De Castro and I are here as representatives of Europe today, so I think this is an answer in itself. Perhaps the views of Europe are not always properly communicated. And there are attempts to change things in Europe to be able to give a clear message to citizens. Since we addressed the 2008-2009 crisis, we were able to understand many things, why the crisis occurred and so on, but what we have not been able to do to this day, I think, is to propose solutions that can really be effective to this crisis that we are still experiencing. Actually, the 2008-2009 crisis was followed directly by a structural crisis. That's a major area that requires a lot of attention. In 2012, Ms. Merkel came to the European Parliament and said that we had to be brave enough to change the treaties if need be. Now, we are still discussing over this, whether we can and what we can change. The Dublin Treaty came along at the time when there was not the migration wave that we are experiencing today. So the rules made in those years are no longer actually applicable. And there are many other things like the fiscal compact, for example, that were developed in times when the situation was different, and that's self-evident. It's also self-evident that rules apply to everyone, and there's not only deficit but also surplus sometimes, and this is not clearly addressed, frankly. So I think there are many good things that come from Europe, but probably we are not able to communicate them clearly. Very often national governments accuse Europe of being over-bureaucratic, but that's a typical trait of Italy. The environmental impact assessment is made in 6 months in Germany, and it takes 2.5 years in Italy. I mean, 5 or 6 years ago, I met the breeders of my region, animal farmers, and they said that their French colleagues had to prepared documents. There were just 5 pages when they had to publish to present documents that were 100 pages long. But that means that we cannot blame everything on Europe. So politicians who want to speak seriously have to say which are the institutions that have to deal with which problems. Sometimes mayors accuse the national government, and national governments accuse the European institutions. You know what I mean? So Italian politicians are still trying to send a message to their citizens, indicating that politics is centered in Rome, or should be centered in Rome, but that doesn't make sense. But the previous speaker was very clear. He put a number of things to our attention very clearly. Well, first of all, I'm very happy for the opportunity to have a direct contact with this sector that seems to be very lively and active, full of people that work with great passion and with great creativity. So I had this chance because I was rapporteur of the non-road mobile machinery. It was a long work, lasting a couple of years or so, but I really developed a great passion, personal passion, for this sector that I learned to a large extent through this experience. And I'm also proud to say that Italy had a great victory, so we contributed to protecting such an important sector as that of narrow tractors. the solution we found was more creative than that proposed by some bureaucrats. We had suggested to change cropping methods. That was frankly quite absurd. But as Ed was saying, we became acquainted with specific requirements or characteristics of this sector, which has got little to do with the automobile sector. And I think that the Parliament just got that message quite clearly too. I mean, if you work honestly and assess reality, you can do good things. We have to be able to understand the real things and the real options in front of us instead of simply trying to achieve some unrealistic dream. Of course, we would all like to have a heaven on earth, but that doesn't make any sense. Sometimes it really is a waste of time to try to achieve that. The comments I heard today, in my opinion, are very important. Before coming, I took a look at my agenda and I saw that there's no important revision of this sector's legislation in the future. But the market is moving quite quickly towards this major revolution of agriculture, this agriculture 4.0 or 4.0 agriculture. When we talk about innovation, of course, this calls into question the issue of public funding through the Common Agricultural Policy as well as R&D. I think Italians must make sure that they don't lose this opportunity. I hope that we won't do what we did with photovoltaic panels where we ended up buying those made in China. If we don't do that, we may lose opportunities that will be taken by somebody else, such as Germany. Bologna, as we heard, is the city with the oldest universities. I studied in Padua, which was the second oldest university. It was funded to protect the freedom of thinking. It's not a chance that Galileo Galilei was protected as long as he lived in Padua. We were the first to make the Erasmus at the time, if you like. If you come to the Ball, the Padua University, you can find the names of people studying there who were born in all countries in the world. They were already moving around and contacting other countries, other people. So I'm saying this simply to underline that we need to find a way to work as a team. When you talk to Italian farmers and you talk about innovation, they are afraid. But we have to be aware that they have it in their own DNA. The small Italian businessmen are always thinking of ways of improving something like a piece of machinery or whatever. And I think that's what innovation boils down to. And Italians have always been innovative, but they are not aware of being so. So we have to help them learn a kind of new language. When you hear it at the beginning, you have the feeling you can't understand anything, but if you get more in touch with it, you gradually learn what those words mean. And even the messages coming from Europe concerning investment and how to have investment are things that people are sort of afraid of. They feel they know nothing about that, but that's a mistake. You can also make a mistake at the beginning, but it's always a way of learning something. Whenever you make an application in Europe, you have a clear description of why your application was accepted or rejected. Also, in terms of information, we are really far ahead of many others with the Galileo system. So agriculture here could become much more sustainable, might be able to reduce the use of fertilizers to a large extent. So even for young people, that may become a very, or may be indeed, a very stimulating sector, very in line with the characteristics of new generations that like technology and know how to use it. So I think the European decision makers should try not to be an elephant in a china shop, if you know what I mean. Many of these things are going to naturally develop, will be developed by the market, and even Europe has to monitor what's going on, but leave some freedom. I'm speaking as a mother, really. I think we need to use a maternal attitude to this sector that badly needs it, considering also what's happening in demography terms. We need even more a highly clean and sustainable agriculture. For Europe to remain in the leading position, a lot of investment is needed. But as I said, we have to continue or preserve a constant dialogue. When the Common Agricultural Policy was revised in the past legislature, I think a lot of progress was actually made. And once again, I think the Common Agricultural Policy has to change and embrace all the things and the factors that we are discussing today, hopefully under the guide, the guidance of De Castro, the President of the Environmental Committee on Environment, and hopefully we'll also have an Italian Commissioner for Agriculture. Thank you very much. Thank you indeed. You were very kind. So we rely on Venus, if you like. Now, I have a couple of questions to make from you. You have a lot of experience as an international negotiator. What do you think may be the scenarios coming along after the election of Donald Trump? Of course, I'm referring to the Italian and European agri-food industry. And that's my first question. I have another question, though. In the next months, the Common Agricultural Policy will be revised, as Mr. Gardini was saying. In this medium term, how do you think a specific set of rules may be developed concerning agricultural machinery and innovation? Thank you very much. I wish to thank the President of the Bologna exhibition and thank him for inviting me. Can you hear me? Can you hear me down there? Okay, I'm going to make just a couple of considerations. I'll start from Donald Trump. President Trump is going to change everything, if you like, but we don't know how he will change everything, and perhaps he too is not aware of how he will change everything. Nonetheless, we have to admit that there's going to be a completely new approach on the part of the American presidency. For those who deal with the Trans-Pacific, Trans-Atlantic Trade Investment Partnership, for the TTIP, but we don't think that that would be stepped up. I hope it will not be blocked, at least. But what can I say? I'm not sure, of course. We have to wait and see how things will develop and will evolve. Globalization requires a constant comparison between different standards. We have a number of people from the Commission here, happy to see Aldolongo and Barbara and all the others. Now, they will agree with me that the standards are one of the levers in the hands of our companies to increase competitiveness. We have high standards concerning the environment or safety, on safety of workers. We are proud of that. Similarly, we have high standards concerning emissions. But we cannot say the same for the rest of the world. There are some countries that do, others don't, or others do it differently. But we have to compete with these countries. So one of the key problems of globalization is actually how to manage this competing standards. That's why international agreements are necessary. You can't be strong unless you do so. If you don't communicate, if you do not try to get agreements with others, you may remain in an unfavorable position. I mean, Asia, China is an area of major opportunity in the next years. It's estimated that 200 million Chinese people will leave agriculture and move to the cities. That implies that there will be a huge increase in the demand for mechanization. So it's going to be a major opportunity. What remains to be seen is whether the standards of our machinery may be competitive with those of other world producers on that market, and be sure that that is going to be by far one of the most important markets in the future. China needs to produce more. It hasn't got natural resources enough. Diet is changing too, not only as a result of the increase in population, but also in the increase in well-being of the population. So they're changing their diet if they have no land. So there's a major demand coming along. But as I said, we have to ask ourselves whether our standards may make us sufficiently strong on the market. So we have to fight, of course, and we do, to improve our standards, but we cannot lose sight of what other people are doing, other countries are doing. On the basis of international treaties, we may be, if you like, cast away from the business, so we have to be aware of that. Yesterday, with Massimo and other friends, we were talking about the question of prices. There's an improvement there with this dramatic curve of lowering of prices should now be over. Hopefully, this will be a stimulus also to the European market that is not certainly doing very well in the area of farming machinery. So we may, businesses represented here today, may get some hope from that. And I think that that is true for European and non-European manufacturers. Then, of course, this morning we had this shocking piece of news, and we'll see how that is going to impact that. Nonetheless, I think we can say that the trend is changing, and going back again to your first question, the common agricultural policy will undergo a partial revision, and German colleague Anderdesk and I will be the rapporteurs for this reform. We can't, of course, change it completely every 2 years, but certainly some important changes will be, or some adjustments, if you like, would be introduced, some simplifications. And Elisabetta was rightly saying that Italy as the major bureaucracy problem much more than Europe, but certainly even Europe can streamline these things to some extent. Alicia Geruti will certainly talk about what the European Commission wants to do for young people. The proposals made by Dr. Philogamy implies help to young people for access to rural areas and special help to young farmers. The Parliament made a battle to make this help compulsory and not voluntary. So there are many favourable signs, if you like, and I hope that things are going to get better. But an important role will have to be played also by our businessmen, by our industries, and it's nice to see many of those representatives here facing this challenge of a world that needs to produce more with less resources. They are going to have an important role to play. We as legislators will have will try to do our best, but the success depends also on the ability of making trade viewed favorably by the public at large, if you like. CPE and SNB have no doubt about that, but we see that there are many populist parties that are not simply against TTIP, but against trade. Against trade in any kind, in any form. I'm pleased to see also Ms. Nicola Caselli here, and I welcome her. So we have to say that clearly, in the world of quick communication that we are living through, we have to be aware and react to that, because these things are, you know, these tendencies are very powerful. This attitude, based on the idea that we just have to, accuse Europe. This is what British British politics has done for many years, and now they find themselves in a difficult situation. Perhaps, hopefully, at least that will have the effect of a vaccine. At least they will learn what that implies. But there's always been an attempt, you know, to blame everything on Europe. But we are Europe. If Europe does something wrong, we have to ask ourselves what we personally have done to make that happen. I think in the European Parliament there are at least 200 MPs that are working only against Europe, against trade, against European institutions. So even for us, this is a difficult struggle to make, you know. I think it's an effort that must be made not only by us, but by all parts of society, because we are gradually leaving this big building of Europe that we have built for our children is starting to crumble down day after day. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Massimo. I would like to ask the original secretary of Abaco Jacobs to take the floor. You will have certainly listened to the declarations and the statements that have just been made. So would you like to add anything on the top of that? Do you agree with what has been said?
Chairman, thank you very much for the opportunity to speak. Distinguished members of Parliament, dear friends, it's indeed a pleasure to be here for COPA and COREGA, European Farmers and Agri Cooperatives. My two presidents, Mr. Mere from Denmark and Mr. Magnusson from Sweden, send their best regards to your event here and underline the importance of agricultural machinery in the survival of European agriculture. What we'd like to see, quite much in line with what has been said by two previous speakers, that common agricultural policies should remain strong truly common, and it should be simple enough that the operators, especially farmers, can implement it. And importantly, it has to be in line with the market. If we don't produce the consumer market here in Italy, in Europe, in the world, it would not deliver at the end. We need to produce more, we need to produce better. And in doing so, we need to accept the fact that we are more exposed to international trade than ever before. I started this work 10 years ago, and I can tell you that there's a clear difference in 2007, 2016, when it comes to our orientation. We were more defensive, we were more protective to European-owned single market 10 years ago. This time, and especially after the Russian embargo, we are more exposed and we have to act accordingly. However, I would like to underline the common feature, common nature of the policy framework with our industry, agricultural machinery industry. European agriculture has been an extremely well-performing sector over the past 100 years when it comes to producing more and better and in a more sustainable manner. Despite the hiccups, despite the problems, we are still the world leader. And that goes not only to European agriculture, but also to European agricultural machinery. You are a world-class operator within a world-class agri-food chain. And especially when you take a look into the recent figures in exports, we export 130 billion euro worth of agricultural goods, and we import 115. So we are the biggest contributor to the net trade balance, positive net trade balance of the European Union. And this is thanks also to a large extent your important role. When it comes to your specific questions, and I'm not going to repeat all the aspects that have been pointed out, but we have also amongst farming community and our corporates, we have an issue on the fact that European Union's regulations and national regulations put increasingly pressure on compliance. So we have to follow fairly rigid, especially environmental legislation that, like Mr. President Macwell said, actually originates from automobile industry. And we have a problem with that because we see that the industry, agricultural machinery industry, is not treated on its own merits. And this actually cuts down the innovation, motivation for innovation, which we see some good, startups from your sector, to be frank. This sphere shows, this equipment here shows clearly that motivation is still there. We need to address some issues like big data, and especially when we take a look into the new opportunities that this digitalization of European agriculture, agri-food chain would bring. But it's more to do how. And I'm very pleased to see that we have some major stakeholders, of course, CEMA being one of the organizers, and Mr. Benjamin from CETA here to discuss how we should organize ourselves, especially how we organize this agri-food chain, especially for that cherished consumer information, informing consumers how we do it, and getting the information and feedback from the consumers, what they are willing to pay, what are their expectations to agri-food chain as a whole. We need some innovative tools, and therefore you cannot exclude agricultural machinery from this scope in the European Union policy framework. It's very much about increasing value to value chain, and like I said, it's very much about collaboration between the stakeholders. All, for instance, machinery industry representative, and we enjoyed good collaboration on narrow tractors quite recently, and we continue doing that in some other issues. ABS requirement to tractors, road vehicles is another issue that we need to address. However, I'm looking forward to our discussion, and especially for future development in our sector. And I can't avoid touching about one item that President Macron pointed out in his speech, and that is a structural change or structures in Europe. And this is particularly the case here in Italy. Italian agriculture certainly is not known for not having good quality foodstuffs. But then we also have reasonably small size farm structures in Italy. The question is how to organize this within the expectations of society And therefore, we are so pleased to see that the European Commission, the European Parliament and the Council jointly agreed on the Common Agricultural Policy Reform that actually promoted joint action for farmers. Producer organization concept, recognition of the importance of cooperatives is an important tool. We see good opportunities, for instance, in contracting, which is important sector in certain sectors already. I personally have very good experiences of contracting. It enables my business and my neighbor's business to come forward with technology that they wouldn't have otherwise access to it. And so therefore, we certainly welcome these new developments and we are willing to take a look into new opportunities. But I would like to conclude by saying that increasingly we need to have tailor-made solutions for those farmers' needs. And especially when we talk about young farmers who enter the sector, their expectations for the sector, they are twofold. First, any young farmer entering the sector, and I challenge my vice president from CEMA on this, is to make a decent living. And so what they do is they invest into their own future with expectation that they make a decent living that is comparable to any other sector in the European economy. We cannot say that this wouldn't be a valid expectation. And especially when we go for this, we need to have investment. And in particular, when it comes to the young farmers, European Union policy has failed to deliver an opportunity to increase public support to young farmers when they enter, and in particular, by failing to deliver in the second pillar, rural development programming, we have let down our young people when it comes to their investments for more sustainable, high quality, bigger volume agricultural production. Ladies and gentlemen, I expect that we will have a lively debate and looking forward to your comments.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, and we have to say goodbye to Mrs. Gavini, who is going to leave us. We talked about young farmers, so what is the contribution that young farmers can give?
Okay, thank you very much for the invitation. Also on behalf of my president, Alan Dego, that is to be here. What do we expect?
Sorry, do you understand the calendar, but you speak in English?
Aye, because I saw that nobody had headphones.
It
was the majority of headphones. We were actually talking on the bus. Is innovation the solution to attract young farmers? I wouldn't say a solution. I would say a tool, because as Mr. Pisanen said. As young farmers, and you all know the rate, the percentage of young farmers in Europe that is very scary and also decreasing. Young farmers, why would a young farmer go back to agriculture or start farming? I think that he has to believe in the sector. So what does this mean? He has to believe that farming means feeding the world, feeding the consumer, and so there's, I think, is the point. We have to network with the consumer. We have to make we have to have the right tools for farmers to understand that they are doing a great job. And innovation can, of course, be the right tool. Why? Because innovation translated in knowledge, because if it stays innovation, it's not enough, is the right tool to produce better. As we said, yes, the sentence produce more for an increasing population, but we also have to produce better. So what can technology bring us? So what can be the benefits for young farmers? The benefits are reducing costs, of course. So the reduction of inputs. To reduce costs, as we were saying, we have to invest a lot, because it's not only investing in automatic guidance. We have to invest in sensors. If we only invest in sensors for the sowing machine, for the sprayer, it's not enough, because we have to invest in sensors also on the combiner, because if we don't do that, we don't have a right result. So the subsidies has to be targeted. only who has a real project. Only if there is a result, the subsidies should go, and that is very important for us. Apart from the reduction of the costs, what does innovation, knowledge, information bring to young farmers? The benefit is time. We will save our time. What does save time of production bring to? Not only an increasing of production, because we are not the US. I mean, the average surface of a farm in Europe is not, we cannot compare it to US. But this time, as young farmers, we can invest it in entrepreneurship. So we can invest it in communicating to our consumer the added value of our production. Why? Because we are producing better. We are producing better in terms of environment. We are producing better in terms of standards, as Mr. De Castro was saying. We are producing better in terms of quality, the intrinsic quality of our production. So, what do we need? What are our ideas to propose? Is a more dissemination of best practices, so a type of network, as we were saying, synergies between farmers, experiences, good practices, to make it more feasible for us, because often we would like to invest, but we don't know exactly how, since it's not easy to use big data, it's not too easy to use all this technology. And then we need tools to communicate to the consumer that our product is really an added value, has really an added value. Does this mean standards? Could mean global gap, could mean it all translates in more traceability, in more transparency. Because for us, a big solution for the crisis, an important solution for the crisis, is actually the traceability, the transparency for us, for our production. We believe in information dissemination. So for us, it was very important the EsoBoost technology. We are actually working on our position paper, so that the farmer has an easy, simplified way to use big data. And so we can work not only on simplification of the technology, but also on the increase of the output. So on the provision, we can, a year for another, and maybe also with a long-term strategy, know on which inputs and which technology we can invest. Of course, we agree with the problems of the costs of the EU regulations and the administrative burden that for young farmers is, for all farmers, of course, is a big challenge. So what we think is that innovation goes beyond technology. For us, innovation is also conservation agriculture, for example. And it's networking. It is a big innovation. Like we are working on the food chain, so why farmers, it's important for us to have more synergies with the food industry, of course, in an equal and sustainable way. So yes, we believe that the future is cooperation, is dissemination of information, and this could also be a better internet and broadband connection, because it is a big limit for us. And I think that if we all work together in these terms, also including consumers, as Mr. Persani was saying, and including all the stakeholders, we can forward a better future. Thank you.
Both Alice and the President of Copenhagen, Mr. Persson, stressed three main topics: to produce more and better. So we have a structural change awaiting us, and then the most important aspect is innovation and technology. Mr. Klaus Kemp, as President of FedrUnacoma, what sort of cooperation can there be between contractors and companies? And even more importantly, what are contractors asking for in order to reinforce their sector, in order to have better precision farming.
So that's a hard thing if you talk to me in that way. At first, thank you to be here at this conference. It's good for me. I'm a German, and so I'm sorry if my English is not that good that you can't understand me. I hope the Italian translation is better. Okay. So what happens to contractors with the integration of agriculture machineries, and what our working together with the producers of machineries? That's what we have to do the last years. We have some problems with the innovation now. Since 2009, we were still working on the agriculture 4.0. But we have a problem as contractors. We have customers, they have used John Deere machineries and other machineries like at New Holland, and everyone has his own solution, you know, in 4.0, in electronic stuff. And we can't talk together with a machinery from Fendt to a John Deere or to a Krone or to a Deutz Fahr. We can't do that. You know, that's my problem as a contractor at the moment, that I want to correspond with my customer, the farmer. So I had to work with the big machinery producers, that they come together to find out to work together. And then the other thing is that we work in modern art, but we talk all the time, who's the owner of the dates? Anytime when we make a new conference about 4.0, it's who's the owner of the dates? The farmer say, it's my data, because you take it out of my farm. And I tell them, no, it's my data, I take it out of my machinery. And so, you know, there are the problems, and we can't go on in that way. We are used to go on. Yeah. And so that's the thing we had in the past, but nowadays we work together with the associations of builders of machinery, also with the farmer association and the contractors association. We are the customers. We come together and we say our wishes, and not what we have to buy. We want to show them what we want to buy, and the last years is going better and better, and I think it's a good work together in this way between us. And the next thing I can tell you, we have some problems with regulations, lots of regulations. Because contractors, they are used to drive wide machineries. We like to drive in Germany since 3.50 meters without any regulations, but it's not allowed any longer. We now, I think, we can drive till 3 meters wide machineries. That's some problems, but only for the road. The next problem is, the last years we buy tractors. And these tractors have all the same things inside, without changing the motor, because it's good. We have to clean the air, we have to do something for us in cleaning up the air and the world. That's okay, but the regulation of that was that the whole innovation, or 75% of cost of innovation on tractors the last 10 years goes only to clean up the motor. What I want to say is, if I buy a machinery built in 2006, it will be the best machinery for me, because it's the same tanker inside with a cheap motor. You know? And so what happens in Germany, we take a view set, and the EU said we need tier 3. We said, okay, you can do that, but when the machinery came into our shed, we take it out. But it costs me too much money. I'm one of them, or we are the people who wants to give machinery a chance to be efficiently or rentable. That's what we want to do with machineries. So we take this tier 3 out, and we don't need so much fuel. You know, we need it at the chopper, we need more than 10 liters less when we put it out again. So that's the money I can use to pay the driver. And it's not good for the air, but I know that's not good for the air, but what we don't do at that time is to think about how work better and how work on the fields better. That's what we do with 4.0, we could find it out. If we drive over the fields and we have good machineries, GPS steering, we only need 10 times to go over the same field. In the future, or in the past, we go 20 times over the field, because we have all this overlapping and that things, and it was not good. So what I want to say with this is that we have to put all our innovations together, and we have to come together and say what innovation can do good things also for healthy, also for a good world, for good air, for everything. And I think we stop too much innovation because we have too much regulation in this moment. It's not the problem of the EU on their own, I have to say. We have some things to do, like to harmonize machineries with America. And they say, we want to have this, because in another form, in another art, we are not allowed to send out our machinery back to America or whatever. And they want to bring it into Europe. That's okay. That are harmonizing things we have to do, but sometimes we have to look if we have too hard regulations, and the regulations take the money for innovation or other innovations on the machinery. That's not so good. I think we are the best in Europe, we are the best industry for agriculture machineries. You can see that we are a world player for that. Only some big companies coming out of other countries making also very innovative agriculture machineries. But in Europe we have another thing. We have lots of players, family players, that are machinery fabrications owned by families. It's only in Europe you find that bigness. And this machinery should work together, and they have to do that thing. They sell you something you put up behind a big tractor. The tractor is coming out of a big concern, but the machinery behind, she wants to talk to the machinery in front, to the tractor. And I said, at least what I can tell you, in Germany I told them, not the tractor has the intelligence, you know? That's like we plow with a pig or with a cow in front, you know? Where's the intelligence? Intelligence was behind. It was the man who was steering the plow. That was the intelligence. And so, a lot of intelligence is coming out of this innovation people here around, and they build machineries, they're very innovation, but they can't talk to the machinery in front. And that's what we have to look for the next years, that we put them together. We have to come together on big tables, on round tables, also with the politician people, to say what kind of innovation use is the best for all of us. And it's the same now, you talk about this, it's the brakes with ABS. That's a regulation. I think we don't need it so much in agriculture. The tractors, I don't heard about tractors who made big damage without ABS, but now it should come in. It's another innovation. It's okay. It's a good innovation for cars, but cars are built for customers. A tractor is not a building for customer or machinery for customers. Cars are machineries for producer. It's a producing machinery. It's like a machinery in your fabrication at home. That's not a car like I'm driving on Sunday anywhere, or I make shopping or that things. That's customer machinery, and the customer has to be said what he can do with the machinery and have this things. We take it as a machinery for production, for our products, and so we decided if it's cheap in one way, or it's rentable or efficient. That's what we want to look for, the machineries, and that's why the reason we buy those machines. That's, I think, all I can tell you about that, what contractors thinking about innovations and come together and put innovations together.
Thank you.
You're the last speaker, and I think that you are very lucky because many different comments have already been made, and food thought has already been provided, so many interesting points have already been raised. So as part of your organization, what direction are you taking, and is there any chance to provide an answer to all this need? Thank you very much, and thank you for inviting me. Well, I actually have a privilege because I've been listening to all the other comments and statements that we made, and I've also read some of the documents that he sent to us. So, very much in line with the philosophy of the Commission, and very much in line with the need of a better regulation, very much in line with the need for new rules and regulations to support digital innovation. Well, I think my DG is not only in favor of innovation, even more importantly, when it comes to the industrial sector to deal with, we really try to make sure that all these principles are then put into practice. Let me now turn to the priorities that have emerged out of today's debate. If you consider regulations, and if you want to make sure the regulations really support innovation in the industry, then it is very important to have harmonization worldwide. Professor De Castro pointed that out, many other speakers pointed that out today. So we are talking about a global industry. As Europeans, we're very ambitious because we want to protect the environment, we want to protect workers, we want to protect safety on the road, and we want to make sure that this is the case in other parts of the world where the growth is higher than here in Italy or in Europe. So we want to make sure that awareness is raised on these topics, and we want to make sure that our countries are being compliant. This was the direction that we have taken in the past few years. If we consider work safety standards, all this is based on OECD standards, and our Commission has fostered our cooperation with the OECD in order to make sure that our European guidelines are then compliant with worldwide. And this also comes to the priorities that the OECD has put on its own agenda. And all these guidelines are then being complied with in Europe and around the world. Let me now turn to emissions. One of the guidelines of our reform as regards the Euromobile machinery is the harmonization with the US standards. We're talking about a global industry, so we want to sell everywhere in the world, and it is clearly we want to have harmonized standards. This was the fuel rule of everything that we did from a regulatory point of view. Having said this, we have to be aware that specific sectors have very specific situations. And the European Commission, together with the Council, fought to find again a technical solution like the narrow sectors. So harmonization is important, but we also need to take into consideration specific features of every single sector. We started a dialogue with the Environmental Agency in the USA, the IEA. The Euromobile machinery standards have been recently revised, and we want to make sure that, again, that everything is done in cooperation with us. And we also talked about trade agreement. PDIP, this is something we are closely following, and one of the proposals of the European Union is to set up a regulatory forum or framework. And so we want to discuss together with the Americans, and we want to delve into possible regulatory approaches that go in the same direction. And we need to have a very comprehensive approach. And again, I think that there is room for improvement here. We need to consider trends in terms of supply and in terms of demand. So we want to make sure that we act very consistently when it comes to the standards and regulations at all institutional levels. CEMA proposed format last year, which was very interesting. This helped us to enter into a dialogue with all the departments of the Commission that deal with agriculture, DG Agriculture, DG for Information Society, Environment DG, and my DG. And I think that the format that has been put forward was very interesting. Now, Having listened to our speakers today and with the cooperation of CEMA, I think that we should just try and do the same. We should just convene at the same meetings, and possibly we should also involve end users into this forum. And we should foster a particular framework to foster innovation. The Commission has done a lot from this point of view. One of the priorities of this Commission is to create a single digital market. This is why we want to have intelligence standards and regulations. We want to have the necessary funds to support this. And we need digital skills. Digital sector innovation will require, again, many different. When it comes to the regulatory aspects I deal with, our regulations are performance oriented, so we don't impose the use of any specific technology. Again, innovative technologies have to be authorized, have to be approved of, and I think that the regulatory framework really allows us to foster innovation, but if there are any critical issues, then of course we are more than happy to discuss about them. It is very important to foster the dialogue with the stakeholders. Over the last few years we've done a lot to do this, and our work has been very active and has been providing very important contributions. There's still room for improvement, so we could try and anticipate situations. This holds true for regulators as well as for the industry. We were faced from time to time with worries and concerns when the legislating process was already drawing to an end, and we really want to avoid this. Last but not least, we really needed to have an intelligent and a better regulation, and in order to provide this we need data. We want to have environmental impact studies that are really again real, that really help us, and we needed to have trustworthy data to do this. So we need economic and statistical analysis to support our studies in order to make sure that our regulations really make sense. Thank you very much, Barbara. That was very good and straight to the point. So to conclude this very interesting roundtable, I would like to give the floor to Mr. Longo, Director General of Environmental and Rural Development of the European Commission.
Thank you so much. I wish to thank CEMA and all of you for giving me the opportunity to take part in this conference. And I want to give you my best wishes for this 42nd edition of your exhibition. We are cooperating very actively with CEMA, and we hope we'll continue in this direction. But I also wish to take the opportunity to bring you the greetings of my commissioner, who has not been able to be here today. He is involved in a trading mission in Indonesia. He has already gone to Vietnam to promote agricultural products made or produce made with your machinery. And apart from promoting agricultural produce, we may in the future go there to promote our machinery as well, in a kind of silos breaking logic that I think may be quite correct. I was very interested in the comments made by the various speakers this morning. I want to go back to a couple of things that were mentioned. I'm thinking in particular to what Mr. Gardini was saying about the complexity of our regulation. We are actually trying to work to streamline it and simplify it. And I want to give you a few examples of some success in this area. Sometimes we don't simply need to simplify legislation. We need to be aware that we have to work simply, if you know what I mean. Recently, we worked on a financial piece of legislation and we invited Casa Depositi e Prestiti, the European Investment Bank, the European Investment Fund, the European Commission, of course, and Italian regional institutions under the auspices of the Ministry of Agriculture, and we have been able to discuss together, and we set up a guarantee fund aimed especially at increasing investments in the sector of machinery. It's a multi-regional fund where the regional institutions take on board a large part of the risk. So we encourage banks to invest more in agriculture. Hopefully, this will stimulate banks to be more actively involved in this sector. I also wish to thank Mr. Fan and Mr. Caselli for the very interesting contributions, as well as Mr. Ferrero from Piedmont. I want to thank them very much for the great help they gave us. Listening to Barbara and the other speakers, I really got the feeling that the sector of agricultural machinery is not like indeed the car sector. It's got some specific traits and it requires more specific ad hoc solutions. I don't want to go into that because I think this has been clearly explained by Barbara. I would rather make a comment on another issue that was broadly conjured up by the other speakers, i.e. the development of digital technology. This digitalization of agriculture, which is now going on. And it's, I think, one of the most significant traits in this sector. All of us, the Commission, CEMA, the public administration, all have a role to play in this. Digitalization in the agricultural sector and in rural areas is expected to open up new opportunities for companies, products and services, and digital techniques or technology can help us solve many problems, such as reducing pollution, reducing environmental impact, using production factors better, increasing transparency in the food chain. And I think we all have a common feeling of being really on the eve of an epochal change in the area of agriculture. So the purpose will have to be producing more with less. We also discussed the question of digitalization together with representatives of CEMA to see what were the main obstacles to this process in agriculture. And three main problems have cropped up. One is the low acceptance of risk by farmers. They legitimately ask themselves whether this kind of investment makes sense economically. And that's, of course, quite understandable, also considering the low price of agricultural produce. And a second obstacle is that digitalization is expected to change the present business models. New companies are cropping up, offering new products and services, and this process will continue. Some companies may, for example, sell data collected by drones, or could be tractor manufacturers that also sell software to manage technology inside a company. So the digitalization implies really a change in our way of thinking. A company's prerogatives are no longer in the hands of its owner, but they are really governed by technology, digital technologies, and those who master them. Finally, many farmers and companies are not happy to share their data unless they know exactly how they would be used. There are three main obstacles to the spreading of digitalization in agriculture, but there are also others, such as the actual effectiveness of network infrastructures or the interoperability of systems. And I think CEMAC is actually working on that too through his book. Let me also briefly mention the digital agenda, which is one of the priorities of the Commission. It's a strategy that was developed for the digital single market, with the DAY acronym, the acronym DAY. There are two parts of this strategy that I want to highlight. One is the development of digital platform, and the second is to develop poles of digital innovation throughout Europe. The Commission wants to launch an initiative to support the development of digital platforms, and with particular attention to two parts, if you like, two issues. One is the Internet of Things, and I think that in this exhibition we have clear examples of that, and the second concerns data platforms. The second action envisaged by this strategy are the fora for digital innovation throughout Europe. And you may be interested to know that there's an interesting event coming along. Now, we are really working to guarantee a major interaction with structural funds and the PACE, the Fund for Strategic Investment, especially for small and medium-sized enterprises. These tools could certainly be used better and to a larger extent. I think it's interesting to note that all European countries have developed their own strategy for innovation. If we compare them, we see that there are some regions that have some common interests. Some of them, for example, are trying to develop an agri-food platform with the help of the Commission to stimulate investment through projects in a number of regions. The idea of having a network of regions that share the same interest and make them able to work together is an important strategy. This platform for agri-food industry will be launched in December, officially on the 6th and 7th of December, and I hope that Ulrich and CMA will be involved directly in this activity. Let me also briefly, before I end, mention the instruments managed by us that are part, if you like, closer to the Common Agricultural Policy. Apart from the rules and the digital and the rules in the hands of the UK Commission, what we do is, on the one hand, we manage the European Programme on Research in Agriculture, and around the AHAZA, we give concrete stimulation to innovation through the Rural Development Policy and the European Innovation Partnership. This new instrument for innovation that was set up on the occasion of the latest reform. Digitalization, by the way, is going to be a priority for my commissioner in 2017, and he is now organizing a number of events that will soon be announced. But before I go into detail on the action for research and innovation, let me mention an important initiative that might actually bring about an important change. The innovation process. I'm referring to this guarantee fund that I mentioned earlier on. This lending opportunity might be very interesting in terms of its size and the ways in which it's going to work. With this guarantee fund, the risk will be shouldered by the public partner, by the state, so there will be a lot of effort to develop portfolios for agriculture. Rural development policy, the rural development policy also exploits digitalization to provide new help to investments, and it offers opportunities for make investments to develop wideband networks, large band networks. We are announcing now, with the help of Commissioner Hogan, we are going to fund and open a single office that those that want to develop large band can turn to for any information and help. We also invested a lot in a pilot project of the Internet of Things, and I hope that this will bring about, will raise a lot of interest. But at the same time, with the contribution of the farming machinery sector and the agricultural organizations, we are trying to develop a very important research program that will get a lot of funding from 2018 to 2020. The digital issue will have a key role in this program too. But let me go back to the question of partnerships and partnership projects. At the moment, there are about 200 projects in Europe that have already started off, and one-tenth of them concern precision agriculture. If we extrapolate this for the whole series, in the end we may have 300 groups doing innovation concerning precision agriculture. So that would be a very, very powerful tool in our hands. Now, of course, this is also a demonstration, and for that reason, it may really help farmers to feel less at risk. When they see that some projects are feasible, they may be more likely to accept the risk of making similar investments. Now, I think I will stop here, and I apologize for being a bit too long. I'm not as good as Pickup and Turner, who is always straight and short in his presentations, nor am I as good as Dr. De Castro to make also some political considerations in the discussion. But I at least hope I was able to give a nicer picture of what the European Commission does, with some evidence that what we do is actually a major effort to meet your requirements. Thank you very much, and I thank you and all the other speakers. I think you gave us an excellent explanation of what the European Commission is doing. I just have one information for the speaker and for our guest. We're going to meet here and then move upstairs for lunch. Thank you.